yeah, how we doing tonight? Alright. Who's here that's gonna give up the Lord tonight? I know you're seeing. Amen. Amen. We're excited tonight. Who did an opening prayer? We'll give a thank you, D. You stand up. Go right ahead.
Our Father and our God, we come before you this evening, Lord, just to say thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for your many blessings. And thank you for the loving protection. And most of all, Lord, we thank you for the precious gift for your Son.
Yes.
Who came
you,
down from heaven.
Yes.
To hang on a piece of wood.
Yes.
To save my soul.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
This we thank you for. If we had a thousand tongues, we couldn't thank you.
Yes.
And in Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So tonight we continue with the road less traveled. Forgiveness.
Mm.
So when you think about forgiveness, you think about the road less traveled, sometimes we have to ask ourselves, do we understand it fully? Do we understand it at all?
No.
Forgiveness. Easy word to say, as some say, hard word to live by. Mm. But is it important as a Christian to have forgiveness?
Yeah.
Does it affect our growth if we don't forgive?
Yeah.
How so? When you don't hear from God,
get real frustrated and discouraged, big time, lose your joy.
Mm. So all these words we're hearing, forgiveness, joy, not hearing, not following, blessings, this word is just as important just about anything else in our relationship, is it not?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it is a catalyst of why we even became Christians.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Right?
We did not become Christians because Jesus healed the blind. Right, Nate? We didn't become Christians because he raised people from the dead. Right?
Right.
We became Christians because what? So if you don't have this or the desire to obtain it, can you truly say you desire to be saved?
I mean, if the foundation is Christ, then it's also built on forgiveness. I mean, that's where it starts. That's where Christ started with us.
That's the foundation, right? For God so
loved the world
that he gave his only
begotten
Son, whosoever shall but have
everlasting
life.
That don't sound like forgiveness. So sometimes I think we confuse our gifts with the gospel. If you really, really stop and think about it, Doc, people are more concerned about what they can do than why they do it. Dare I say it, Marvin? They're more concerned about what they're doing than who they're doing it for. So if I'm doing things because of a certain person, place, or thing, when they, not if, but when they upset me, argue me, I'm going to lose the power of forgiveness. And we talked about it. Forgiveness is really not for the other person, right? What is it for? For you to be available for others. So why do we fight it then? Why do we fight forgiveness? I really want to help people. I really want to be a blessing to folks. Why do I fight forgiveness?
Because we think we deserve to hold the grudge.
Okay.
Selected.
So, explain. Right there, Doc.
So, I want to help who I want to help. If I don't want that person to be helped, my forgiveness, I don't.
We hearing ourselves tonight? Mm-hmm. We talk about it all the time. Putting what? Situation, right?
Salvation.
Over what?
Salvation.
Over salvation. Which hinders us. See how that comes in? It comes full circle. We need forgiveness in order to really righteously be examples of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Right.
Anyone disagree? Look what he says. Tonight we're going to talk about forgiveness. We're going to talk about reconciliation or restoration. Reconciliation or restoration. Somebody can quickly Google. What is reconciliation? What is that? What does it mean to reconcile? Who works in accounting? Or any type of business? You ever heard of reconciling?
Yeah.
The books? What does that mean? Okay. What has to happen to reconcile? What has to happen?
Balance.
Order. Right? So let me hit you in the head with something. Even if the statistics are right, they're only as proper as the person who entered them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's so true.
And we're built on statistics, right?
Mm-hmm.
Survey says
guilty.
Right?
Yeah.
But if we think about it, if the person who's doing the statistics is not right, how are the numbers right? Data. The data is only as good as the data entries who put it in there. We would like to believe these 40 plus authors of the Bible who most never met one another heard righteously from God. Did they have flaws? Yes. Did they have issues? Yes. Were they perfect in the sense of the word perfect? No. But they had a desire to follow God like we ourselves to help make this a better world. Restoration. What does it mean to be restored? What does that mean?
Repair. To be made whole.
Repair. Made whole. To bring back to a better form. Right? I don't just want to be made whole. I want to be made new. Isn't that what he said? Old things will pass away. No. Ask yourself, what old thing do I keep carrying in a new world?
Mm.
What keeps hindering me? I say I'm over it, Teresa. I'm done, child. I'm good. Are you?
At one time, you're still being developed.
Mm-hmm. You have to remember that. In evolution, there is an ongoing process, a daily walk. Almost what the old folks used to say, you have to kill yourself daily, right?
Yeah.
The flesh.
Even though we have been born redeemed.
Right.
But we are being killed every day. If you in Christ.
With the mindset. Now listen, let me help you. God did his job. He died for you, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got to do something. Well, Jesus paid it all for you to do something. He didn't pay it all for you not to do anything. Am I wrong?
No, sir.
And sometimes we cling on to these, you know, inept words that leave us still hungry, still lost, still angry, still depressed. Mm-hmm. We go, Jesus paid it, I'm a child, I ain't got to do nothing. Nothing? Nothing? So why would he say trust in the Lord if I ain't got to trust in the Lord, Mother Rachel? That don't make sense. That makes sense to you? Why would I need to trust in the Lord if he paid it all?
I don't know anybody that makes an investment and don't want to return.
Ooh. Ooh. What are we investing, brothers and sisters? When we have the opportunity to get up in the morning and head out to this cruel world, what is your investment?
Trust in the Lord, he will direct your path.
I look at the squat channel in the morning. Y'all may not know what that is. Some of you do. It deals with the stock market. It tells you what's up, what's down. But what it represents is values. Mm-hmm. And every morning, that value changes. Some days, sorry, that value is up there. Some days, it don't look too good around. Some days it's in the middle. But we serve a God that no matter what it looks like on the outside, the value still is of a high and excellent status. So you have to ask yourself, when I wake up in the morning, do I really see God in a high manner? Am I getting up? Whoa, Lord, I thank you. Well, I'll get on there, Lord, another day. I don't know. Charlie, people need job. I can't stand these folks. But quit. No, I can't quit. I got to pay my bills. But you wanted a brand new car. Yeah, Charlie, I had to have something so I can get around. You know, I do what I do. One hurdle after another hurdle after another. Never grateful. Never thankful. How can I have a forgiving mindset if everything was a curse?
Wow.
Never been blessed. Natalie Cole, I'm catching hell.
Come on, Reverend.
That's a nice song for y'all. Check out in your off time. She wanted her man back. But anyway, forgiveness is not the same as reconciliation. Forgiveness focuses on the offense. Where reconciliation focuses on the relationship. I'm going to show you how we're going to make that work. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness requires no relationship.
Uh-oh.
Ah. Back to what you were saying, Doc. It's situational. If it worked for me, then I reconcile. If it don't work for me, I see what I can do. Mm-hmm. But in forgiveness, Aaron, I got to forgive folk I know I don't like.
I'm
smiling while I say that. Right? Can we be transparent tonight? Yes.
You have to forgive people to release them for whatever God has for them, because sometimes you may not, I'm going through this right now.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord spoke to me and said, you need to call this person or reach out to this person. Not because you are holding a grudge against them or anything against them, but they need it. Mm-hmm. So that they can be released from whatever stronghold they're going
through. Yeah. Because sometimes people think, how many people, every time you have people say, well, child, she don't like me. How you know she don't like me? I just know it. What? I just know, child, I know she got a problem with me. I know it. I was talking with one of my children the other day about how do you go and be with people who y'all argue before you get where you're going and say y'all gonna have fun. Somebody harboring something.
Right.
Because that's what people do, right? Everybody don't have to forget, child, we good, don't worry about it. Let's go out there, let's have fun, let's do it, let's turn up. Everybody, somebody going. I'm going to go.
But.
I'm going to be stank the whole time I'm there.
You have been so.
Can we be transparent? The whole time they there. So Cassandra looks at me, and I look at her, and we say, why they come?
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What am I saying? You all, we have to be prepared for people, who may enter our house of worship.
Yeah, come on.
Where we're trying to have joy and, have a real high time with God, and they want to sit in the corner and say, they don't dig all that. All that extra.
Okay.
Oh my. And that's fine. You feel that way. But I think about, I was telling this other day, this is my new niche. We were blessed last night to be at the Salvation Army. And you ladies can help me. You gentlemen jump in again. When the Bible talks about praising and worship, when you come to a house of worship, who is usually the most
women.
Praising of
women.
People, men or women?
Women.
Women.
Yeah. Always. Yes, sir.
Always. Women.
Help somebody.
So I said, how you mad?
Uh-oh.
That your lady.
Come on.
Or your daughter, or your sister, or your mama, or your auntie, who praise God more than you.
Uh-huh.
Which means if they praise God more than you, they got to be praying more than you.
Uh-oh.
How you got a prayer and no praise?
Right.
Not possible. Right? The prayer should give you a praise. Now, if I'm wrong, help me, Pastor. I'm trying to learn. So when your female counterpart comes to you, saying this is what God said, you get ruffled because you have not been praying and praising.
Uh-oh.
So it is your job to make sure you're the number one praiser in your house. Well, let me help you. How is it that when Jesus died, you're still going, right? Can I finish it?
Yeah.
Laid there all day Friday.
Come on.
Saturday morning. Saturday night. Got up early.
Sunday morning.
Sunday morning. And the first person that went to check on him.
Women. Yes.
Women.
That's scripture.
Wasn't a man. Wasn't none of his disciples who ate with him, drank with him, hung out with him.
That's good.
Saw him feed 500, 400, saw him walk across water, saw him turn it into wine.
Come on.
All that they saw. So if we're not careful, men, we could be the catalyst of why our households don't have forgiveness.
All right. Wow.
Because we are the head of our household.
I know that.
I know what you're saying. Yes. Think. Yes. Let me help you. I ain't trying to rewrite the book. Just for a second. Indulge me. Book of Genesis, the Lord said that from his image, he made male and
female.
So, listen to this. Second chapter, he breathed into the dust and made man.
Mm-hmm.
So why didn't he do that with woman? He could have just breathed again.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Because she's a part of me.
So why didn't he just say, man?
Woman.
Woman. You would have been what?
Equal.
Y'all don't want to hear this part.
Real rapper.
Let's answer the question. Let's learn. Let's learn. He did it. He did it in spirit.
Yeah.
Why did he change it in flesh? What's in your theory? I'm just. He said he did not want. Now listen. Technically, spirit-wise, he was not alone.
Right.
Because he had made both male and she was in waiting.
Right. Yeah.
But she was available. Right? So then he breathed and made man.
Right.
Said, you know what, bro? I don't want you by yourself. Think about it now.
Yeah.
Put him to sleep.
That's fair.
Made woman from the rib of man.
Mm-hmm.
And when he woke up, he said, whoa, man. Why?
Oh, man.
And I don't try to rewrite the Bible, but I want you to think about it. So when I say he is a catalyst, see, I don't let men get off on nothing. We are the conduits to God.
Right.
Straight up.
Right.
We're not better than women, but we differ. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. That's it.
We were made different.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You're in charge.
Say it again.
Be free.
However, think about it. The woman's the easiest to get to.
Mm.
Not just with God, but also with him. I know y'all ain't gonna hear all this tonight.
Oh, yeah. Pastor say you got a lot of women. You don't like women. Women are barefoot and pregnant. It's just
that's not what I said. I want you to start opening your eyes so you can grow in this knowledge of God, of understanding we all have a role, and when we don't do our role, we put our role on somebody else. And we put our role on somebody else who's not. It's not their great pay. It's not their pay grade. Don't be mad because your household failing.
Uh-oh.
That's all I'm saying. No, I'm not saying everything is the man's fault. But I said you can't have anything happen in your house and not have a part of responsibility.
Right. I agree. Ooh.
And that's what everybody in the house, however, because you were made under the auspice of what he wanted you to be, the one who made, he named all the animals. Mm-hmm. Say what, Doc?
If you go Genesis chapter 3.
Read it.
We're going to talk about the curse. The way God cursed the man versus the woman was even different.
Yep.
So, curse are above all livestock and with all wild animals. You will probably, that's the Satan, I'm sorry. And I will make enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike your heel with his foot. To the woman, I will make your pain in childbearing very severe with painful labor, and you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. That word desire, when we trying to figure out our man and why he ain't listening and all of that stuff, that's part of that curse.
They don't like what's going on tonight, dog.
That's good.
Yeah, I ain't signed up. Y'all ain't trying to make all this stuff. I am no man. I follow God. I follow no man. I follow God. Well, go ahead.
Even when Eve did what she did in the garden, God didn't show up. He waited on man to be here.
Mm-hmm.
So he checked the man first.
Yep.
Well,
that's good.
He didn't check the woman.
The Bible said that God came in the cool of the moment of the day, right?
Yeah.
So you could tell this wasn't a one-time thing.
Mm-hmm.
He came to his regular spot looking for his regular guy.
That's
for the regular conversation.
That's it.
Daily.
But because Grandma said he had tore his drawers, y'all figure it out later what that means. He shamed himself. He wasn't in place.
That's right.
He wasn't in. He was out of place.
Right.
Right? He hid in the bushes. Let me throw a real crazy question. What is very hard. Right? So we got to ask ourselves, when we're talking about forgiveness, how this thing originates all the way back. Go, please. Come on.
Okay, so you said just a few minutes ago that you just like did a twist on it saying Adam had asked for forgiveness.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm thinking he didn't even know what it was. He didn't even know what forgiveness is. Because some people, like you can have an issue with somebody and bury it so deep that you don't even know that you have that issue until you get that trigger. Until you're wounded and somebody gets that wound, and then you're reminded of what they did.
So let's stay there. You're spending all this time with God, and you ain't learning nothing.
I thought we were talking about people.
Okay. Adam himself. That's right. What we're talking about now.
Okay.
Why didn't Adam know or not know? Then you would have to ask yourself, what was he really learning from God? Mm. Now, whether he knew or not, he knew enough to know what he had been told.
Right.
Don't eat it.
Right.
How much more do you need to know? Huh? Mama said, don't go out the door. How much more do you need to know? How much law and pictures and movies and folk at the door, you got to know, I can't go out the door.
Right.
That's where I'm at. Even if I don't know biblically what to do, I got examples in front of me every day. Run a red light, get a ticket.
I know.
Well, I ain't know I can run a red light. How you ain't know? Now, there's some things we just got to quit lying about. Can we be tricking ourselves? I'm saying in general. There are just some things that you ain't got to be a scholar or a theologian of the Bible to know that it's wrong.
Yes, sir.
You married with a girl across town. How much you need to know that ain't right?
Come on, Reverend.
Well, my daddy did it. That make it right?
No.
Huh? That's all I'm saying. I'm saying there are sometimes we give people too much credit of not knowing when they know. Folk know what they want to know. Huh?
That's real.
They know how to cuss you out. So how you know how to speak your tongue?
Wow. They sure know when you're doing wrong.
That's what I'm talking about. People know what they want to know, and they talk about what they want to talk about. And sometimes, because we're Christians, we give them a pass because it looks better. That's why if you don't come to Bible school and Sunday school and Bible study, the excuse is, I don't know.
How did Adam not know he was he wasn't a leader. He wasn't leading Eve at that point when, you know, he followed her. So that would be the sin, right? I mean, that's like the original sin because he failed her.
You know, he failed big time. Mm-hmm. And if we go back or fast forward a little bit, what is the biggest things in the Ten Commandments? You will have no other
gotcha.
Sometimes if you're trying to please some place, some person, something over the Spirit of God, you're wrong. Didn't he say come out from your mom and dad?
Mm-hmm. So which sin was first? The apple or Adam?
Oh, God.
Alright, we'll talk about that another time.
And we could go over that. For me, I could be off track, really, now. I don't want to get too deep in that because I wasn't there. I just tend to believe by human nature. See, what we miss a lot of times when we're listening to all this is free will. God gave us that. Free will. Free to do right, free to do wrong. And so, was it a test? Because what do people desire now more than anything? They want to know everything. They come into the room, they got to be the sharpest knife in the drawer. You know, they got to be able to be eloquently different from everybody else.
Come on.
Instead of just following what has already rolled. Mm-hmm. We got to be unique in some form or some fashion. That's why the internet gives you the opportunity now to step into the real realm of dysfunction. Mm-hmm. Because people are just following people. They're not they're following stuff because it attracts the ears, the itchy ears, all that. The Bible talks about it. But when you start talking about forgiveness, it hurts too much. Right? Things that I really need to focus on, if we really be transparent and honest for just a couple seconds in our mind, the stuff we really need to focus on, we move it, we swipe it. The stuff that really weighs us down and burdens us, mama can't get off the phone. Smith, what's going on, lady? Talk to me. Girl, if you want to check. Now, you ain't hear this from me. But Luther May, let me tell you what happened to her. All day long. We remember I told you, they did a survey. They said 70% of a person's day is negative. 70%. That's a lot, Rabbi. You sleep six, eight. So that only leaves you by, 18 hours? 16 hours? So out of that, 12 hours your day is negative? You only got 4 hours, but things are kind of okay? Look what he says. He says, however, reconciliation requires a relationship in which two people are in agreement. Remember, they talk about when you go to the courthouse, divorces or whatever, they have to go back and forth, right? Until both can say, okay, that works. Mm-hmm. But does it really work? Somebody still feel like they got hoodwink, right? Mm-hmm. She got $20 more than I wanted to pay. Right? She's getting a real out of that one. He says, do two walk together unless they have agreed? Let's look at the Amos 3 and 3. Old Testament, New Testament. Oh. Written by who? They're saying Amos. What does it say? Amos 3 and 3.
And two walk together except they be agreed.
Now, just because we have agreed doesn't mean that we're being restored. Right? What is an agreement? What does it say, Pharaoh? Agreement. Agreement.
But two people agree with one another.
What does it say?
The absence of incompatibility between two people.
Well, both sides.
Absence of?
Incompatibility.
Okay. Don't match up. But, what else?
Consistency.
We talk all the time. What's the role in an argument?
The win.
Compromise.
Is there compromise in forgiveness?
No.
You feel like it is, but it's not.
That's not
forgiveness, God. Mm-mm. That's a compromise. Forgiveness says, as what you say, Doc, you release, right? You release the person, the place, the thing from the issue. Therefore, I can't compromise. If I compromise, that means, well, I'm gonna cut it loose for Friday, but we're gonna pick this back up Monday. Is that a compromise?
I feel like there has to be a little bit of compromise as far as like, okay, I gotta put myself down, put whatever I feel aside, and like see the bigger picture. So you kind of compromise to an extent, not in a bad way, but
okay,
it's a little bit of compromise.
Okay.
Like, I gotta see your point of view a little bit in order to forgive you.
Ah. So let me help. In forgiveness, and this might sound a little wild, their point of view can't be the dictating or the factors to why you forgive. Because their point of view may never line up to you, or your point of view may never line up to them, therefore forgiveness can never truly come in. Forgiveness is saying, remember, forgiveness is between you and God. But we try to make it between you, that person, and come back to God. But remember, you don't have no control in this part, right? If you and Cuzzo don't, if he don't want to make it right, in forgiveness, right? He wronged you, but he won't make it right. But you won't, you went to God about it, and God says, leave it alone.
Right.
But you keep coming back here because you want him to line up with God. But he won't line up with God because he don't see God like you see God.
That's good.
So if you're not careful, this will become God.
That's real.
You'll be closer to this than you are to God. Because you're looking for him to make you feel better. And that's when you've given power to the wrong person, place, or thing. And that's why we talk about it's a lonely road, Teacup. Because it's not a road people travel all the time. It's hard. When somebody done some stuff to you that eats at your soul and your conscience, you know, that you just can't seem to get out of your system.
Come on.
Yeah. Christian uses the analogy, you drink the poison, but you hope they die. It's not going to happen that way. And so what the enemy does is they keep plugging at you. Child, if they would only do this. Child, if he would just say he's sorry. Child, if he would just make it right. Child, he don't know you hurting. Child, he don't. And then but you got this relationship here, though, that you're not pouring into because you're too busy pouring into this one.
So
it
becomes disconnect.
And really, you're not pouring into it. You're pouring it on the ground because it ain't hitting nothing.
Right. Mm.
They closed their cup now. Mm-hmm. They're not receiving anything you give them.
That's real.
Say again. They're sitting there watching you. They sleep with both eyes closed. You tossing and turning. You putting all kind of crazy stuff on Instagram. You doing all kind of crazy stuff on Facebook Live. You calling them this and a bag of chips. And they sleeping in both eyes closed. But you say, I can forgive them, but I can't forget. No, you ain't forgiving.
That's real.
With the intent not to forget. Can you remember? Can you recall information?
Yeah,
that helps you what? Guard yourself. Mm-hmm. But if this becomes an issue where you find yourself, this they have to agree in order for me to be free, it'll never happen.
That's like the snare then.
Say again.
That's like the snare.
Yes. Explain it to them. My daughter likes to learn.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay, so in Amos 3:5 it says, does a bird fall into a trap on the ground where no snare has been set? So if we're going to the source of where we don't forgive somebody, we're going to the trap. Mm-hmm. But if we go to God, then we're not falling into the snare because there's no trap set there between us and God.
Perfect. We actually made the snare because we went to an area that we didn't belong in. And sometimes in our lives, we're freely walk. Forgiveness is a decision to release the offender. Mm-hmm. Reconciliation is the effort to rejoin. That means there's still leave room for them.
Walk it tonight.
Mm-hmm. Think about it. Child custody.
Help somebody.
You get the baby on 1 week, I get the baby on, but I still got to see you in my hand when I get the baby.
Come on, Reverend. That's real.
A man now. Who that woman got in the car? Who that man you got in the car?
That's real.
Right?
Yes, sir.
I'm upset. Forgiveness involves a change in thinking about the offender. That's when you really know. Right?
That's real.
Mom, you were saying a friend of yours, when now you can look at him and say, you know what? Hey, man. No harm, Father. We're good. No harm, no foul. We're good. Love you.
Yeah.
Right?
That's it.
I got peace. If you're around somebody and then they just irk your skin and everything, you're not forgiving them.
Nope.
And what really hurts is you really want to move to the next level and they find where they're at. They don't lose an ounce of sleep, son. You're crawling and scratching. David Chappelle, right?
Wow.
And they're fine. Forgiveness involves a change in thinking about the offender. Reconciliation involves a change in behavior by the offender. They have to now do whatever what the court says, right? That don't mean they change, right? They just change how they had to operate.
Right.
And so you have to ask yourself, when you decide to become in the walk of Christianity, changing your behavior don't mean you change. By you changing, your behavior is made pure. Right? It's a thought process first, right? Then we talk about the heart is to do. That's what the heart is. The heart, it does. But the mind is the set to keep doing. That's why you have to strengthen your mind. To not just do it one time, but to keep doing it. Get up, come on Sunday. Get up, come on next Sunday. Get up, come on another Sunday. Get up, come on Thursday night. Get up, come on another Thursday night. Get up, come on another Thursday night. But isn't it amazing how we can get up to go to things that don't really represent God?
Come on.
And the things that do, we struggle with? You go to a job where you know they hate your guts. ain't no guess around it. You can't get along with them, right? You can't get nothing out of them. They won't get nothing out of you. Come to the house of God. Ah, child, I don't know if I can make it today. Pastor understand. He know what's going on. Everybody ain't healed.
Wow.
What?
He got
to
make that face.
Forgiveness is a free gift to the one who has broken trust. Listen to this. It is a free gift to the one who has broken trust. That's what we're talking about restoring, right? Reconciliation is a restored relationship based on restored trust. That means basically I will, because certain parameters are in place, I'll trust you. I'll go along because the judge said this.
Yep.
Right?
It's unconditional.
Exactly. Forgiveness is unconditional, though. Right. That's the difference, see, money? Yep. When you start thinking in the mindset of forgiveness, it is unconditional.
That's right.
Reconciliation deals with conditions, right? Mm-hmm. This has to happen in order for this to happen. This has to happen in order for this to happen. You have to have this in place in order for this to work, right? Supervised visits means the visit has to be right? That's a condition. Right? Joint custody means that the custody is. That's a condition. Right? Hmm. So my first point, what I wanted us to look at, and so we did it today, we now are understanding, and this is just agreement versus understanding. That's what my first point is about. Agreement versus understanding. The Bible says that in some things, most things, get understanding. Right? Even if you don't agree, you get understanding. Right? You may not agree when it comes up, but the understanding is everybody is understanding what's being taken place. Forgiveness is extended even if it is never, ever earned.
Say it again.
What does that mean to somebody?
Even if that person...
never do you right.
Right.
Because it's not about them. It's about them.
Explain.
Because you're in bondage when you don't forgive. So in order to be free, you got to forgive regardless of what they do.
And what is the goal in forgiveness? As Christians, what would be the real goal for us if we forgive? What's the benefit for us if we forgive?
To reconnect back with God, draw closer to God. Because with unforgiveness in your life, you're not as close as you think you are with God.
But what if I'm a pastor in the church? They're a Christian.
Pastor.
What if I'm a chief apostle, bishop?
You're on your way to hell.
Or the fourth order and the third heaven.
On your way to hell.
Are you still human?
Rightfully so. But what if I'm the armor bearer to the prelate?
You still got sin in your life? You still need God's forgiveness?
But I'm the CEO of a Fortune 500 company.
What that mean?
Can we kind of look out and say, as we look at the world today and see what's on the news, that there's a lot of unforgiveness in the world? Anyone disagree? What do you see that helps you think that? What are you seeing?
Anger on people's faces. Inhumanity in their actions.
Inhumanity.
Yeah. We had 190 mass shootings so far this year.
Yeah. And they haven't even publicized it like that. I just did a survey last night. Thank you. They had like 20-something 4th of July week. Mm-hmm. Day. 4th of July. And a mass shooting now, anything over 3 people being killed.
Yeah.
And it's so regular now, it's not even being promoted.
Yes.
You had something, Tisha. And then, boom, here it was. People are comfortable walking in the grocery store, shooting and killing people, watching them die right in front of you, and that don't affect you? That's scary. People slam into your car and then drive off? Don't know if you were hurt, don't know if you died. This world is becoming an unforgivable place. Good job.
And if you don't believe that's true, I was on Silver Star in Hiawassee one morning on my way to work. Mm-hmm. This man jumped out of his car and fired 5 rounds into another car, another parked car. People all around. I was hysterical. Called 911, and they're asking me, you know, a bunch of questions or whatever. But I was in so much disbelief that a person would just do that. Mm-hmm. And you think that, you know, you're safe and you can just walk around and just go to work like a regular day, that that wouldn't happen, but you have to be armed. Mm-hmm. Like, spiritually armed.
Yeah.
To be able to, for, I didn't even think I would ride down Hiawassee anymore after seeing that.
People are so even unforgiving to themselves. I remember, first thing maybe you remember, I was at our hotel for 2 days hanging out. One day we had, was it 2 or 3 that died in your hotel?
2 on that day.
2 on that day, overdose. Gone. The third one was just having to wake up, like, you know, like last second. He was on his way. People are so withdrawn now that they're, this is what I'm trying to, so if I'm willing to take myself out,
it's becoming the norm.
But watch what you say to me. And so I'm so, I've never been as conscious as I have with my kids. Listen, go where you gotta go, come home.
Right? Come on, that's good.
Go where you gotta go,
come home.
Come home.
Right.
You can't even take the risk, Tisha, of going anywhere else other than where you're supposed to go.
Thank you.
I'm not saying you got to live in fear.
No.
But what I'm saying is you got to be realistic now. You can't do some of the things that you used to do back in the day.
Not at all.
So it behooves us to have an environment that when people come here, they need to feel spiritually safe.
That's good.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
So the last point is, first one was agreement versus understanding.
Yes.
Justification versus sanctification. Now, the last one is learning how to moving on versus moving forward. What's different about that?
You can move on in any direction.
Ah. Moving on versus moving forward. Explain that again, D.
You can move on in any direction.
To include back where you came from.
Yes, sir. You can even go back.
Don't look back.
So we got to ask ourselves, when we say, I've forgiven them, have you moved forward? Because moving forward evolves you, elevates you.
Yeah.
Moving on could you bring you back in a U-turn.
Yeah.
That you have to live that whole experience again.
Yeah.
And some of us, we got family and friends, they keep experiencing the same chaos and drama. I know I got them in my family. Y'all gonna help me, y'all.
Yeah.
Okay? I got a close family member. I just watch him. He's like, he keeps going up and down the same road as if he never been down it. Like, he don't know what the outcome will be.
Well, that's the same way Jesus, that's the same way God told Lot and his wife to get out of the sin.
Yeah.
That's it.
Move forward.
You know what I'm talking about? In other words, she wanted what back then. And you know what happened.
Yeah. She turned around.
You are.
She was moving on.
Yeah.
But she.
In her back.
And that's what we're living in today. I'm talking about you living in a world that I don't care what you do, you ain't going to correct it. Only he's going to correct it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about one day he promised you a home.
And remember this.
And what happened here? You got.
Go ahead, Doc.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Dick. I.
No, I'm talking about other words. He said you're going to have trials and tribulation in this world, but be of good cheer. I have overcome this world. He didn't say you weren't going to have problems, but he said, I go away and prepare you a place.
So,
in my father's house, there's many mansions. Yeah. One so I would not have told you.
So, how can I overcome if I don't come over?
Ah, that's good. I call it.
How can you overcome if you don't come over?
Come on, Reverend.
Right?
Yeah.
What we have to do is we have to give up control.
Yeah.
We want it. We desire it. We crave it.
In this world ain't going to never forgive up for control. You must be redeemed.
So well, you don't even have it.
Yeah.
They desire it, but you don't have it.
Yeah, right.
But, what you do have is concern. They believe they have control, but you don't have control of nothing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if you have a concern for something, you give God room for the control over it.
Yeah.
That's how you keep him in charge.
He's over all of it. God is over everything. Now, to my man want to be in control, but he's not in control. Yeah. God is in control.
Stick to concern.
If
he takes control. Makes sense?
Yes, sir.
So forgiveness is obtainable.
Yeah.
Hard,
yeah.
But obtainable. Mm-hmm. Possible.
Okay.
Question of the day. What can I do when I don't feel like forgiving? That's your test for you to take home with. What was last week's? What was the question? Who's got last week's?
What way?
What'd you have? Okay. Did anyone do it? Anyone? What you have, Christian?
I believe you have to humbly stay before the Lord in prayer.
Prayer? Okay. Very important.
Prayer. Prayer.
Yeah.
Prayer.
Yeah, pray.
Prayer. Anyone else? How many of y'all have a schedule? Some kind of a schedule for you college graduates. How many have a schedule of some sort?
We all got a schedule.
In that schedule, where's God time?
First thing in the morning.
First thing in the morning, okay.
Yeah, and I just want to say this. That
yes, ma'am.
Last week I was in Connecticut, and everybody that I ran into, I was telling them, come to Florida, come to our church.
Amen, Mama.
Everybody says to me, so Dorothy, you down there in Florida, and you telling me that y'all are so happy down there. Are y'all getting ready to have a government that's gonna get guns to anybody that wants one and without a permit?
Pretty poor understanding already do it.
Right.
I know.
I said that. That's what I said.
Yeah.
And I said that the one thing that we all have is God.
That's it.
I said that's the key.
That's it.
And it is prayer.
Yeah.
For us. To have the key. So I said that if you believe and trust in God, his will is always the best.
What did we just talk about reconciling? People gonna do what they want to do.
Anyhow.
Right?
Yeah.
So that all the guys who talk about, I'm gonna get me a license now, even though I ain't gotta get it, I'm gonna get one. That reverse psychology ain't gonna work.
Right.
Right? If Pookie been canning, he gonna keep canning. What I tell them what you're missing now by not going to get the license is the training. What are you gonna do if your gun jams up? Do you know how to dislodge a bullet that's sitting, what we call a double feed, two bullets in the chamber? It's in the pipe. Do you know how to get it out? Because when it's popping off, you ain't got time to go back to look at the book and pull up a YouTube video. So you got a weapon that you don't understand? Because they said I ain't got to have no license? Not my choice to speak on that because we live. Anyway, I will say this. Prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Prayer. If you ain't never, Grandma said, if you ain't never prayed before,
pray now.
Yes. We're planning here in the winter. We're going to be having some prayer nights a little longer than an hour. You'll be able to come in and we might be here at 9, 10 o'clock. We want to stop by, we'll have a nice down low, little music playing. All I need is quiet. You want to talk? Don't even come in the parking lot. Go down there to Wendy's and talk down there. I don't want to hear you screaming and hollering and laughing and talking in the parking lot, throwing people off.
All right.
You're coming here to pray.
Yep.
Amen?
Amen.
That's where it's going to be. But that's coming up. You're a real soul. What do we have coming up? This is Second Sunday, Women's Sunday. Okay. Amen. Anyone before we close? Tony, you think you got it?
Yeah.
All right. Pastor, yes, sir.
I want to ask you one thing.
Sure.
What about burden? Is burden is in forgiveness?
Speak on it. Let's hear it.
Talk about
burden. Burdens.
Yeah, if that's your burden, if that's a burden to forgiveness,
it shouldn't be.
Okay.
If you, he
I'm
said.
About, he said, cast your burden.
Right. I get what you're saying. Yes. Yeah. If you're having trouble forgiving,
yeah.
Then you need to take it to him.
Yeah.
So that burden can become a blessing. Because yeah. If you don't get rid of it, it's still a burden. And a lot of us are carrying burdens with me. Very good, Deke. Thank you for the insight.
Yeah.
Anything before we close out? Hearts and minds? All right. Remember the 23rd. Second service, we're going to Greater St. Paul, AME, on Paramore, 4 o'clock. Those who can and will, please. First Lady and Teacup, Tiana, are putting together, we're going to have an order sheet now for those who need shirts, t-shirts, polos. That's coming up. You should be able to get this stuff. We're trying to get there as soon as possible here in a little bit. So please check your group me or listen up on announcements on Sunday. That's coming up. All right. Please.
Yes, sir.
The 15th is our back to school event. We're partnering with Cornelia.
Woo-hoo.
Anyone that can and help can and will help us, we need you that Saturday morning at 9 a.m. at Cornelia. All right. Jocelyn will be speaking on behalf of our youth. During that day. All right.
Amen.
Anything else? First thing you got anything?
Nothing.
All right. Let's collect our offering tonight. Those that can and will, if you'd like to bless us, go to our website, www.mztcc.org, Mount Zion Tabernacle Christian Church.org. Click on our PayPal there and help us toward greater. Amen. Speak to my heart, Lord. Be a prayer, man. As we continue prayers for Mother Porter, she is still trying to recoup. We'll keep her in prayer. Right, she had a procedure yesterday and today. So she's still trying to recover. Keep Mother Croker in prayer as she is recovering. Amen. We send our prayers for her as well. You're welcome, dear. Father God, we thank you for this offering tonight. We have a blessing and we'll keep you in your kingdom. In the grace of our God, the love of Jesus Christ, as we commit the Holy Spirit, may it rest from our henceforth now and forevermore. As we walk by faith, never by our own sight, giving the glory, the honor, the thanks, and the praise, we all say together, amen, amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being with us tonight. We have myself, the beautiful lady, First Lady Tamika Murray, the Mount Zion Tabernacle Christian Church family. Well, all you need is a touch from him. Thank you. God now.
They're loud.
They are? Oh, they've been...